Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage President and CEO of iNACOL, Susan Patrick.
Right, did everyone enjoy the reception last night? Thank you for being here this morning. It's my great pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, Gene Wilhoit. Gene Wilhoit is the CEO of the Center for Innovation in Education at the University of Kentucky, a partner at Student Achievement Partners. Gene previously served as the Executive Director of the Council for Chief State School Officers, CCSSO, from 2006. In 2013, he went over to CCSSO at about the same time I went from the Department of Ed to NACOL, now iNACOL. And he's spent his entire professional career serving education at the local, state, and national levels. At CCSSO, Gene spearheaded the state's collective action to adopt the Common Core state standards. He marshaled a comprehensive restructuring of teacher and leader supports, including gaining consensus on preparation reform, stimulated state action to improve data systems, and founded the Multi-State Innovation Lab Network. From 1994 to 2006, Gene led not one, but two state education agencies as director of the Arkansas Department of Education and Commissioner of the Kentucky Department of Education. Gene began his career as a social studies teacher in Ohio and Indiana. He served in the Indiana Department of Education. He was an administrator in Kanawha County, West Virginia, and a special assistant in the U.S. Department of Education, and he was the executive director of the National Association of State Boards of Education, or NASB. So this is someone that deeply understands the local context, the state context, and even the federal context, and has some amazing ideas about where the leverage points are in the system that we can move towards change for student-centered learning. Gene holds degrees from Georgetown College and Indiana University. He is a member of numerous education organizations, serves on several boards, has served on national and state commissions, and has written and spoken on a variety of education issues. I just like to say, when I first met Gene, when I was at the U.S. Department of Education, what struck me is how incredibly, deeply committed he is to kids and to students. He has a way of thinking through all of the complex issues that cross over systems and separates the wheat from the chaff, really honing in and focusing in on what we can do to leverage and make change happen and make systems change happen to have dramatically better learning environments for our kids. It is my great pleasure to introduce one of the finest people that I know. I'm a huge fan, Gene Wilhoit. Thank you.
Good morning. Well, that's a weak good morning. Good morning. All right, we're going to get together here. Thanks, Susan, for that introduction, particularly the latter part. I don't think anybody has recognized you during this conference. But as someone who has been around you and this organization and seen its rapid growth, witnessed your personal impact on this organization and on others, I think we all owe you a round of applause for what you've done for iNACOL. And I am a fan of yours. I also want to recognize another person in the room who is my partner at the Center for Innovation and Education, Linda Pittenger. Many of you know she serves on your board and is now serving in the role of president of that board, and Linda, I wanted everyone to know how much I deeply appreciate you. She's an educator par excellence, and my pleasure to know her as a colleague and, more importantly, as a very close personal friend. So, Linda, we thank you for what you're doing at iNicole. I really have looked forward to this invitation from the time Susan asked me to come back. I'm excited about the interaction, and the reason is that a few years ago I did appear before this group, admittedly a bit smaller group than this one, but what I remember about that interaction was not the profound and inspirational message that I gave. I even have forgotten what it was. I think it was some harebrained idea like states ought to get together and develop common standards around college and career readiness or something like that. But that wasn't what I remember. What I remember is the enthusiasm that I experienced from my direct interactions with all of you and the engagement that you had, deep engagement you had around the issues you were wrestling with and the commitment to each other and the sort of tendency toward action, this sort of impatience to get ahead with it and do something about educating children. So it was a great experience. And not to put any pressure on any of you, I want this audience to supersede that impression that I had of the last meeting. But thanks for inviting me back, and just having been here for a time, I can see that you have refined, developed a deeper understanding of many of the issues that you were addressing a few years ago. You've expanded the conversation to areas that include ideas that are right on the cutting edge of education improvement in this country, and as I said earlier, the group continues to grow and grow. So this is exciting. I'm going to start this morning by going back to something that Susan put up on the screen when she ended her comments. And I'm going to try to focus this conversation this morning around those challenges, because I think she is, from my opinion, right on track. This network, all of you are doing wonderful work, but you're at a point in development where you're going to have to consider some very deep thoughts and questions that are going to be before you. Your real questions she asks here are we really ready to lead, in essentially, this kind of movement of transition to these learning systems? What kinds of opportunities and access are we going to be able to address, open, challenge? How do we begin to use technology in ways that are positive and productive in future education? How do we make sure that we hold on to this idea of student-centered learning? And do we have the real leadership qualities, those instincts to address what we all know are inequalities in the system that we can no longer perpetuate, and know that the center of this conversation really is not about our comfort, our dreams, and our ambitions, but about those youngsters that we serve each and every day, and particularly those who are being left out of this system, and then what will I contribute to this kind of exercise? So let's try to make sense out of all of this morning, and it seems to me that as we try to answer these questions, I want to do some checkpoints with you first. We at the Center for Innovation believe that we've done about everything possible to fix our inherited, our legacy system, schooling. We've added on programs, multiple programs. We've reorganized the desk and reorganized them again. We've asked more of our teachers. We've blamed our teachers. We've put in place compensatory programs, accelerated programs. We've added classes and subtracted classes. We've done all of these things without, in all of those efforts, without seriously questioning the basic tenets of schooling in America. And despite our efforts, we still expect all students to enter school and begin learning at a certain age. It's even encoded in many state laws today. you have a magic birth date in which you can begin learning, or you just missed it by just a few days. We still have formal learning, engagement in specific hours. We move through the system in our schools in the same subjects, in the same sequence. These practices, no matter how much we tinker with them, don't make sense in America today. We have to begin to change and challenge all of those systems. And that's time, it is time to shift from this idea or emphasis on fixing schooling as we know it and moving to a concept of enabling powerful learning for every child in America. When we commit to this kind of vision, you know what happens? We have an intellectual freedom that we've not experienced before. We begin to think about things and get permission to cast aside ideas that are inhibiting our ability to move forward. We expand our thinking into areas that we had not contemplated. We begin to create solutions to problems that we have not been able to create because we were fixing our schools. So I want a checkpoint, because if we don't agree on this, I might as well sit down and you have a free time. And that is this community in agreement with me around this idea that in America today, we need to begin to address this issue. We've worked hard and we're not making changes. We're not getting to where we need to get. Therefore, are we willing to shift our conversation from schooling to systems of learning for all of our children? I want to see it. Who's with me on this? First point, that's where we're going. We're going to equip our youngsters with the knowledge, skills, dispositions that they need to enter this world that we don't know what it will look like and what challenges they will face, but we can equip them to be there and to be successful. Next, I think you are going to have to count yourselves among those who are going to lead this effort. Somebody's got to step out. Now, you're a likely group. I call you pioneers. I think Susan used that phrase in her introduction. But you are among that, what you termed 1%, who are willing to venture into the unknown, not knowing what that will produce, but you have a vision of a better world that others might follow. I think you're among that group. And I think you have done some things recently that give you the capacity to do that. You're embracing the concept and opportunities around competency-based learning. You were the first to bring forward these ideas and tools around expanding learning opportunities of blended learning, online learning. You're beginning to vocalize and develop proof points around how this can happen in exciting and different ways in our society. You're beginning to build those kind of success proof points that are going to be necessary. You have a unique ability. The question is, are you willing to leave your individual interest and step out into the world and become a leader for this transition we're talking about? So, are you ready to go with me? Is the next question. Amen? All right. So we got a vision. We're going to do it together. So third, I think we need a partnership, because I don't care how hard you work. I don't know how good your programs are. I don't think you're going to be successful to anything in large scale until you begin to work with your partners in policy. I'm from the state. I'm here to help you. That's your reaction, and I understand it. But we can't continue to fight each other on this. See, those who attend to systems and policy can shape your world in a positive or in a negative way. And there's all kinds of evidence of both of those around us today. You showing us that you're capable of leading on the front lines. There is somebody in this audience this morning that's doing something that can point the way to this transition we're talking about. And there are those of us from this policy world that need to be your partners. All of us need to challenge ourselves to come together, because to get where we're going to need to get is going to require strategy, and it's going to require an attempt to systematically bring our ideas together in ways that make sense to the world. At the heart of this is this concept. We are basically at a point in our learning process where policy and practice need to come together in very exciting ways. See, I think we got to stop working around the system and work on the system. I know this is a big leap for many of you. I may not get as many amens on this one as I did the first two. For I know the frustration that some of you have chosen, and to face and in a sense create an alternative system around the problems you're facing. I know some of you are creating unique solutions where you can see results, where you can move and control your world despite what might be happening around you, where you can measure success, work on more finite and definable ways, because you have, at this point, little hope that you can impact on a larger scale. But I believe this deeply. We don't have another choice. This work we're about is about all children. It's not about a few. It is about basic equity and basic opportunity in these United States of America. Therefore, we have no choice. We must be bold in our thinking. If all kids cannot share in this groundbreaking work, this exciting work, this inspirational work that we're engaged in, we are continuing to create profound inequalities in our society. Heavy burden I'm laying on you. But we cannot continue to ignore the harsh reality that so many of our students are being left behind by us, the adults. Too many young people are disconnected from schooling today. Too many parents are pleading for a different educational opportunity for their children. Too many business people are pointing out the disconnect between the needs they have for the future and the skills that these youngsters are bringing to the workplace. Too many institutions of higher education know they're admitting students who are not going to be able to meet the challenges that they're going to have to face in those institutions. Schooling, as we know it in America, is not where it needs to be. So, we're at a point where we're going to ask you to take a stronger role in leadership. And we must bring you together to practice policy together. Engage with us in this policy opportunity. And you know what? This is an opportune time to do so. Schooling as we know it is not what it needs to be. It's basically in a weakened state. It's an opportune time for us to take on this vulnerable system. And on a more opportune way to look at this, educators are ready for it too. Teachers are excited about the potential of the work that we're talking about. They're ready for better experiences for their children and their youth. People are waiting. So, let's agree that we can come together. that we need to begin to think about ways that we as a community can begin to influence others as we, the 1%, pave the pathway for the others. We're going to have to come together around a compelling vision that makes sense. And Jim Rickabaugh, it means a vision that we can equip these youngsters. We know what these students need. We know what we need to do to make this true. And we know that everyone is seeking for a way to ensure a brighter future for their children. We don't know what that future is going to be, but we know we can equip them to address that future, to shape it, and to even be a part of the creation of what that future would be. And we need to begin to be honest with folks that in order to get to this, we're going to have to make some really difficult shifts in the educational system. We can't walk away from this. If learning is the sacred cow, everything else in that system is going to have to shift. Let's tell people that and honestly begin to prioritize the ways in which we can begin to shift those changes. And we should not attempt to do this without building the capacity of those who are working on these issues to transform, and that is at all levels in that partnership, and prepare people who can lead and learn in this kind of a system. So for us at the center, we are engaged in a number of activities that begin to give for us at least a sense of what these principles might be. We are at this point in development. I'm not asking you to adopt this. In fact, that would be a big mistake. I'm just putting this in front of you as a way to begin to think about the challenges that lie ahead. But we call it a system of personalized learning. I know some of you call it student-centered learning. That's not the important point. The important point is that we're going to have to develop a system where we have the kind of redesign around a couple of principles. If we're going to develop a system where we have high expectations and those high expectations are aligned with what we know and expect to be the kinds of knowledge, skills, and dispositions that these students are going to need to be prepared for whatever life brings, and we know that the way that's going to have to be delivered is through some sort of individualized and customized learning that leads to students taking full responsibility for that learning and then make that direct connection to learning throughout their lives and identifying with those connections and the power of learning to affect their lives, then we're going to have to challenge basically everything that we're doing. And that means where is learning occurred, how it is learned, when it is learned, where learning happens directly, how learning is demonstrated, how learning is credentialed. All of those issues are on the table. The critical point, we don't give up on the goal of educating, enabling every child to be prepared for life. Then if you stick to that goal, if that becomes the means, then the means become open for interpretation, change, and improvement. Everything in the system. That's where we're going to bump against reality. Because all of us went to school, we experienced school, we know what school is, it's comfortable, we have systems around that that we understand. We may not like them all, but when we begin to challenge them, we're going to have some major challenges ahead of us. So, what might this system look like? We're getting glimpses of that. This is just one example.
So I was thinking about how, you know, what my kids, how my kids are learning, and it seemed like it wasn't very long ago when not this district because it wasn't a district yet, but it wasn't very long ago, just a generation or two ago, that kids were learning in a one-room schoolhouse, and what the expectation of those kids, those pioneer kids, were. And the expectation for my students has dramatically changed. And now, it's not about like when I learned, where the teacher could say, today we're going to be on this page, and a week from now we're all going to be on this page. Now we're meeting the students' needs.
I need to know how to ask questions when I don't understand things.
If somebody just tells me the answers, I won't really learn anything.
Life, you're going to need to be independent. You're not going to always have someone to help you.
The most difficult thing for me is to find the level that my students are across the curriculum, and then reaching their needs and then pushing them to that next level.
Some kids are like further than others. Like some kids are doing multiplication, some kids are doing like statistics, or exploring the median mode.
The whole idea of challenging each student, finding their level and pushing them to that next level, sounds great on paper, but how do we do that? They're coming in being used to being told, okay, here's what you need to know, now learn that. And if I have an entire class at different levels, I have to find ways to challenge them and for them to understand, here's what I know and here's what I need to know, here's what I need to learn.
I need to be able to monitor my understanding to learn how to learn.
And that was always the perfect classroom, if you could find that classroom. And it was never really possible, I don't think, until recently. And that's because of the tools that my students now have. So in the morning when my students walk in, the first thing they do is they fill out a Google Doc. And it tells me what they're working on in spelling, where they are in reading. It tells me what their goals are in math. So just with a couple clicks of a mouse, I can get a quick snapshot of where every student is, and I can set up those groups, get those kids that have similar needs.
In writing, I'm kind of working on making my sentences smoother and not putting in so many conjunctions.
Okay. In spelling, I'm working on word patterns.
Reading, I'm working on finding the main idea and the supporting detail.
I am trying to learn how to multiply decimals.
And the bigger issue is it helps them keep track of their learning. And that's really the most important piece.
I'm working on my means also. But this is going to lead to a whole new design of learning. But look at the excitement, the engagement of both that teacher and those students in that kind of enterprise. And I know many in this room could have done a clip just like that. We're beginning to reshape the very nature of learning. But if I might, I'm going to have the audacity to propose a system here for us to think about. I don't think we're going to get to where we're going unless every one of us begin to embrace a set of conditions that are going to be necessary to get us there. And the first of those is this idea of setting some clear and high expectations. And those expectations need to be grounded in what students need to know and be able to do as determined by society. Society has every right to lay on to us what they expect of our students. We should learn from them and we should set our expectations around them. And we're not going to reach those high expectations and that kind of a clarity until we begin to think about how one exhibits that learning through competency-based learning. So, clear high expectations expressed in learning goals through mastery learning and delivered through customized pathways. If we can begin to think about that as a design principle, then these other three concepts begin to fall in, because we can't do those top three there, clear high expectations, competency-based learning, and customized pathways, without having to address the fact that some of our students need many more supports than we're delivering right now and ignoring in too many cases. They can't do that without jumping outside a classroom. The idea of a teacher confined in a room with 25 folks is a confining environment for learning. it made sense at some point in our history. It no longer does in ours. And this idea of unrelenting focus on student agency as the primary means for engaging them in the learning process. So I want to assume that all of you know what I'm talking about. I don't want to assume that all of you know what I'm talking about, so I want to just very quickly say what I mean by clear high expectations. First, these clear high expectations, as I said, need to be directly connected to the success, knowledge, skills, and attributes that students need to move to the next level of learning. They are based in our expectations for success at those next levels, whether it be college in the traditional sense or in the new opportunities that are emerging, whether it be in a career pathway, whether it be as a contributing member of this society. And they must integrate knowledge, skills, and dispositions. I'm going to come back to that knowledge, skills, and dispositions in a moment. By competency-based education, I mean explicit, observable, measurable, and transferable ways in which students exhibit their learning. I mean by that, instruction is organized around learning progressions that are clearly articulated in a way that teachers understand them and students understand them and can measure themselves as they move through the learning process. I mean by that that then learning is credentialed only through mastery of each of those learning progressions toward the ultimate goal. And I mean by this that students don't demonstrate mastery are given additional support and additional coaching and additional time, whatever they need to bring them to the standard of mastery. We don't give up on mastery. We provide the supports for students to get there. And I mean by that, if a student is ready to master those and can exhibit it in ways that we find are defensible, they move on in the learning process and they're accelerated in that learning process. And by customized pathways, I mean that every student, every learner must have a personalized learning plan. It is owned by that student. It is developed by that student over time with support from others. It is managed by that student. It supports their developmental aspirations. It supports their customization of the pathways that they and you work out as they move through the learning process. I mean by this that every learner in this system will have a learner profile. Again, that holds the evidence of learning as they move through the learning process, and it has numerous sources, numerous evidence that those students can gather and move through the system. I mean by this that learners are experiencing learning in an unbound continuum of learning opportunities. That means that the grade-based confinements, the age-based confinements, the traditionally master schedules, the course sequences, the strains of credit earnings, all must be opened up and accelerated for the learning opportunities. I mean by this that teaching becomes a different sort of enterprise, and the primary goal around that is adapting that teaching process to the learner needs and aspirations. And I mean by this that the learning in this system is reinforced more directly than it is now around neuroscience and developmental psychology. By anytime, anywhere learning, I'm going to come back to, because I think it has some implications for you folks very directly. But around comprehensive supports, I mean by this that the worst thing we can do to a human being is for them to lose hope. To remove from them the sense of a future, to take away from them the belief that in their own confidence to master the world with effort, time, and energy, and focus. Learners must have a caring and sustained relationship with someone in their life. And I think it's every educator's responsibility to ensure that at least one adult is wrapped around every child in our world. Educators can't do all this alone. We shouldn't do it all alone. There are people in this society who can help us do this, and we need much stronger partnerships in this learning enterprise to deal with many of the conditions that students are bringing to our school today. And I believe that it must increase our communication mechanism between parents, caretakers, community members in this learning enterprise. And I mean by this a tiered support from those who are struggling to those who are striving in the system. All families must be directly engaged in this enterprise. And I believe deeply in this idea of student agency. I didn't call it student participation or student involvement. I call it student agency for a purpose, and that is students must grow. We must wrap around them in those early stages the opportunities to begin to grow, to take responsibility for and to manage their own learning program. There's no reason why a high school student in America today could not be managing, controlling their learning environment, pulling around them the kinds of resources they need to engage in learning that around their aspirations and dreams and around their learning styles and around their ambitions. It is critical right now that all of this is reflected in that learning process. And I think it means a different discourse between students and adults in this system. That, by that I mean, it's a reciprocal conversation with respect, with authentic kinds of conversations, and with honest and open feedback. And students can take that and take responsibility in that kind of environment. And by this I mean a much more collaborative relationship between all those who are intervening in the life of our students and our learners. And I believe that this ongoing and emerging part of the process means a different kind of institutional relationship between ourselves and those students. By that I mean this is a non-negotiable component of the learning community, that students are right at the center, and they help us make those decisions. Again, you may think of a different design for something like this, but my point is, if we don't begin to think about how all these systems come together, how your unique work fits into some sort of broader design, and that we all begin to think about some way that we begin to move this system, these things are going to keep us from being successful. We must address each one of them in much deeper detail than we have at this point. So let me go back to a couple of these. The one that I had mentioned here was clear and high expectations. From one who has this Common Core stamped on his forehead, or wearing it on my sweater, I, in my wildest nightmares, never imagined that people would interpret the Common Core as the totality of expectations for learning in this society. It's funny how people become literal in implementation. It is important that we master rigorous content. We have disciplines that are critical for knowledge that's critical for students to master and apply that knowledge. And that's in the Common Core or in your state standards today. Virtually every state has adopted new standards, and they represent this definition of competency in Common Core. But that's mathematics and English language arts. There are standards for the other disciplines that ought to be included in this definition of knowledge of a literate person in this society. It includes those special pathways that students would take opportunity to pursue that would give them a greater opportunity in life, like career and technical education. It includes their ability to master the disciplines for global competency and for citizenship. But if you look at the new definitions that are coming from the states, it's more than that critical knowledge. It includes a set of skills, things like critical thinking, like problem solving, like collaboration, like communication, self-awareness, learning how to learn, leadership. And some of those are included in these new state definitions, some are not. So there's an important conversation that needs to be held in every community, in every state, about what students should know and be able to do in these skill areas. And the real difference in the new expectations that are coming in America today is that it's not enough to simply have knowledge. Jeopardy is now a game, It has very little application to life. It is how one applies knowledge that makes the difference in success and failure. Now, it's not enough. Because when I talk to the business community, they list dispositions, and I just despise the characterization of these dispositions. They're described as non-cognitive. Sometimes they're called soft skills. And literally, we're making a huge mistake if we don't begin to address this area of dispositions. Because things like self-efficacy, the ability to have social awareness and empathy for other people, this idea of taking initiative to solve problems or to persist when you have a difficult situation and not back away from it, the ability to adapt to new and different circumstances in a complex environment, the way to determine what is ethical behavior and to behave in the patterns that demonstrated, the ability to control your life and plan that life and to lay it out in meaningful ways, in essence, begin to separate those who are successful and those who are not. And so all of us in this network have a responsibility to begin to think about how we will define the knowledge that is important, the skills that students must have, and the dispositions that those students will hold. Well, we've sort of been unfair to our teachers in this last area. And just to give you an example of the kind of work that needs to be undertaken, it's interesting that I think in most cases, we've said to teachers, these things are important, go out there and teach them. And we walk away. A lot of teachers' response to that is, oh my goodness, I got to add this on top of all the other stuff you've asked me to do. I don't know how to do that. So it's important that we begin to develop some schema around which teachers and others and students can begin to adapt and begin to measure these skills and competencies. And then we need to put those in place in schools where we can begin to make them a part of the learning process. And as we begin to do this and students begin to work against it, we begin to develop this understanding of how they can become familiar and internalize this and begin to use it as a part of their own development in their lives. Now, as we talk about these dispositions, I think we've really said to teachers, go out, as I said earlier, and do good. But there are really some interesting questions here. How do you recognize the traits? What are the characteristics of a collaborative person? I don't know, is most of the response. How do one help students develop skills around each of those dispositions? How do they take responsibility? How do you measure them? How do you develop learning experiences and build this into a curriculum or instructional design? How do you gather evidence that students are really progressing against them? And so we have begun to think about this in four areas. We've chosen four that research and the states have told us are really cross-cutting in most districts and most states. And when you talk to your communities about what's important in learning, most of them will say, yeah, we recognize that they must be collaborative, that they must be creative, they must be able to communicate in multiple forms, and they must be self-directed learners. Okay, go forth. Well, what we're beginning to think about is, what is that collaborative definition? We've identified in there seven different traits of what would be characterized as elements of a collaborative definition. We've gone beyond that and said, how would we describe a beginner in this process? How would we talk about an advanced beginner? How would we talk about a strategic learner? How would we begin to talk about an emergent learner? Put language around that so that teachers can understand it. And then we've begun to talk about with a community and are engaging now with a group of teachers to put this in practice in a classroom. And we're beginning to think about how does that fit into this whole scheme? We're defining this in a couple of ways. One, in ways that teachers can observe and make clear distinctions about the differences, begin to coach students, but we also are putting this in student language so that they can take responsibility for making those kinds of assessments in their own lives and begin to take responsibility for monitoring this. And you can't imagine how much of an incentive it is when you put this in the hands of a student and say to them, and the learner says, oh, I'm here. What do I need to do to go to this next level? I'm going to take responsibility for that, and I'm going to show it to you in this way, and we're going to talk about it with others who are coaching me and helping me get to that level. This is the kind of deep work we need to do in this area. There are lots of other works along that line. And I said I was going to come back to this critical attribute around anytime, anywhere learning. I think most people still think this is a nice add-on. Let's do what we've always done, but then let's add a little bit of this other stuff. This made sense when we had a community of illiterate people and one person who had an eighth grade education, and we had one little place we could put them and gather them when we're not gathering our crops, and we could begin to educate them to a level where they could read, write, and cipher was the word they used at that time. That world is confining our learning, but it is not. We're not going to get to where you guys are talking about going until we begin to break that out. And in my mind, there are some things that I think this community ought to be working on directly in this area that can move it forward directly. First of all is this issue of credentialing. Until we begin to credential these external opportunities for learning, we're going to continue to have this as an add-on in the curriculum. So, are there ways that this community can come together to begin to define legitimate credentialed exercises that could be a part of a student learning that could be demonstrated on par with and equal to those experiences they're getting in the classroom? If you can do that, then you're going to begin to get an opening there for these greater opportunities that you're promoting. And it is important that this community begin to advocate for ways in which these students can have access to learning technologies, not only for the learning enterprise, but to support in the kind of learning in productive ways that many of you are talking about. Without the technology behind the teachers, we're going to create frustration and resentment. With technology, we're going to ease that burden, we're going to show them ways, we're going to enhance the learning process. Those tools need to be developed. You need to be forming partnerships with entrepreneurs to put these things in front of folks, to engage them in these exercises, to test them out, and put them in front of our teachers. If we don't, we're going to have a backlash from the professional community. And we're going to have to remove the time and place confinements that exist in most state, either regulations or law, and begin to challenge those and bring those to the table for folks to face very directly and to challenge. And then finally, with this tsunami that we had across the country Tuesday, with the election at the national level of Republican Senate majority, we have now folks talking about, oh, what opportunities does this bring about for us in this country? And the immediate tendency on the part of educators is to say, let's get them to reauthorize the SEA. That's a laudable goal, and we all ought to work on that. But I think we're missing an opportunity that this community could come together around. Wouldn't it be amazing if the first congressional action that were to occur in this next Congress is reauthorization of the E-rate? If you guys can do that, think about what's going to happen in America today. Those students who don't have access to broadband are going to get it. Those applications of technology that are now prohibited are going to be available to you. You have defined where this E-rate needs to go. There's no homework to be done here. Susan has that in her pocket right now, and there are a number of people who believe this is a good idea who can help in this exercise. I think the best thing we could do for this next Congress in education policy is to move this through. It is a gift to this new leadership. They can show they can get something done. It's something that the administration will support and has supported over time. It's a win for the new Republican majority in the Congress, and it'll be good for education in this country. You guys have to lead that effort. So, what I basically am saying to you is that this is going to require, make no mistake about it, it's going to cause us to challenge so many things in the system today. We're going to have a new kind of leadership. It's one thing to lead and to manage a stable institution. It's another to lead transformation. We're going to need people to step up who have this vision, who are ready to lead, and have the capacity to take people from where they are through a difficult transition with spirit and excitement and leading to a brighter future. We're going to have to challenge our traditional ideas about research. This idea of conducting a 5-year research, peer reviewing it for 2 years, feeding it into a system as the world has moved along is not helping us at all. The most dynamic learning environment in education today is inside these schools, inside these experiments, inside the places that you're working right now. We need to connect researchers to you with a new design around action research, rapid prototyping, feeding back, affecting the implementation as it moves forward. We're going to need the creation of much more access to and coordination of our efforts around the issues of quality supports and tools for our teachers, our supports and the tools that don't exist today that can open up and enlighten people around these ideas. And we're going to have to be aggressive about our systems that need to be changed. And those system issues are apparent in multiple forms. Right now, finance systems are confining your ability to move forward. We must begin to think about what would happen if we were to say to some local schools, we have a guaranteed amount of money for your students to educate them. Let's agree on what that is. Let's build in the kinds of institutional commitments to the challenges that you face around students with learning needs, language needs, poverty issues. And then we're going to give you the freedom to use that. But here's the quid pro quo, gang. You're going to get every one of them to the levels of expectations that we're laying out there. And I don't care how long it takes you to get them there, this is a non-negotiable. But on the other hand, I'm going to free you up to do this in any way possible. That means you can use your money in any way you assume. And if you can move students through that system and they end up with less time spent in your school than they normally spend, you keep the money. If they take more time to get there, it's your responsibility to get them there. Would people then in that kind of environment begin to look for efficiencies in the system, begin to redesign them? I think so. We're betting on that. We have a number of people who are interested in it, and we're moving on that agenda right now. And we're asking states to make a commitment to wrap themselves around these high schools, begin to protect them as they begin to explore on this, and look at the implications of this work for wider application in state policy. So there are a number of ways in which this plays out. It means much more robust technology and the application of that technology in ways that truly enhance the learning process. It means we begin to develop data systems that are much more supportive of the learning process at the point of learning where students are engaged in learning. It means those systems feeding back to the educators who are directly working with them, but also meet the needs of institutional accountability. And we are going to need a much different pedagogy than we have right now. I want to play this more deeply in another area that is important in this conversation, and it is this issue of assessment and accountability. I hear so many comments from educators that we're trying to do these things. In fact, we're doing things, but we're doing them in secret. We're not going to tell our state about it, and we're going to play their game. We're going to take their test, but we're trying to do things. I'm hearing other people say, I can't do what you're asking us to do and what I just outlined because I'm going to play the game with the state. I know what the rules are. I know where the high stakes are, and I'm going to work against those rules that are very apparent to me. So what are we going to do about this? I think we've got to challenge our current assessment and accountability system in this country. The real goal, and we have forgotten the goal of accountability, the true goal of accountability in this society is to enhance learning. The true goal in this society is to provide information back to folks so that they can make evaluations about current practice at scale or in individual circumstances for learners and engage themselves in a continuous improvement process. It means that we begin to identify these problems, work on them that require corrections, take thoughtful risk, and then move on to the next level. Accountability does not equate to testing. Accountability is much broader and much more complex. And I know there's some people here There are some Aussies here, I understand, and some Canadians. We need to talk to them while you're here. Take the opportunity to learn from them, because we are unique in this country. We have operated under the assumption if we define the outcomes and we measure those outcomes, they will deliver. And what these other countries are beginning to know and begin to put in place is a much more important system. You don't jump immediately from the expectation to the assessment and accountability structure, because in between there is this most important enterprise, and that is understanding what we're asking folks to learn, inculcating that into the system, bringing people together in learning communities, developing very different professional development opportunities than what we have in this country today, and then began to think about how we would measure those. And it is gathering the evidence that's important to show that learning is occurring. And so we have begun, and I showed you the headliner on the piece that we just developed and released a couple of weeks ago, where we're calling for a very different definition of accountability and assessment in this country. An accountability system that is focused on this idea of promoting meaningful learning and improvement and continuous movement forward in a society that is supported by a profession that has both high capacity and deep commitment to the learning of our children, and enabled by resources that are necessary to bring the system about. And what that means is accountability is not on just that learner or that person who's interacting with that learner, that there is higher accountability for folks at the district level, at the state level, at the parent level, and all those who have a responsibility for educating our children. These key elements must not be overlooked in the next accountability cycle. We'll miss an opportunity if we simply tinker and improve the test that we have right now. There's no way that the current summative assessment system is going to produce the kind of evidence that we need to support teaching and learning. It is measurement of the system. It is not measurement as learning occurs or of the learning process as it goes on. And as the longer we leave those two elements out of this enterprise, we're not going to affect the teaching and learning process in America today. So in this piece, we begin to, and I would encourage you to look at this is on our site, and it's on the site of Scope at Stanford. What might this look like? We sort of laid it out in what we called our 51st state. If you took these principles and began to think about it, and I can't go into all three of these areas in detail, but let me give you a glimpse of what might be occurring if we were to really think about this new learning design and this new assessment system. I think it should be based on this idea of locally selected assessments. It's assessments that are geared to giving you deep information about student progress. Gives you enough information to make a diagnosis, gives that student enough information to know where they are against those learning goals, provides multiple opportunities then for the student to know where they are and move forward to the next level of learning. Again, build around what I said earlier are those learning progressions that are clearly identified. That's the heart of the next system. That feeds this dynamic conversation that goes on at the local level. And I think it ought to go on, and every one of us ought to expect that this system is rich enough that it can deliver accurate and reliable data about how students are progressing through the learning experience, growth year to year, and from school to school and institution to institution. And it should flow all the way through that education system. And it ought to be constant. It has given us an opportunity to begin to develop observations around student learning that we will never get. I don't care how well you design a summative assessment, you'll never be able to measure the deep level of knowledge and skills that these students we're asking them to master. And portfolios, extended learning opportunities, scientific experimentation, these kinds of external experiences with authentic judgment by adults and their peers are the ways you really gauge and inform this learning process. And then the purpose of a state accountability system takes a secondary seat in all of this. The real interest of a state is only twofold. It is this school and is this district meeting its compact with the community about the learning goals that we've agreed are important for our students, and are you leaving those children behind? You can gather that kind of information in new, unique, and different ways than we are right now. Now, you might do this validation, and the real purpose of a state assessment is simply to determine that those local assessments are giving you valid and reliable information, that it's an accurate representation of what students know and be able to do. It might be administered infrequently, as I have laid out here, I personally believe, that you don't need to do this every year. I don't think you may not need to do it with every student to get the kind of information you need at a state level to make those judgments. But again, this relationship is very different than one that we have today. Our system is making the most important decisions about not only institutional accountability for which these summative assessments were designed, we now moved it to student accountability and teacher accountability. And these instruments will never be able to meet that purpose. These more locally designed instruments will give you that information, and we can begin to think about a new kind of system. These are the deep conversations we're going to have, and these are the kinds of breakthroughs that we're going to have in order to move the system forward. These systems can give us the quality that we need. It can meet the local needs as well as the state institutional needs that are in place. And you add to that this idea of resource accountability, which is something that is shared by state and locals alike, but it's accountability around how people are allocated in use, how the funds are used in schools, how time is allocated. All of those things cannot be separated from the learning outcomes that students get. So appropriate use of those resources at the local level and at the state level, every state should be forced to constantly think about funding policies that address adequacy of resources to students and the equity of distribution of those resources around individual student needs. And you add to that this idea of professional capacity and learning around educator capacity, both all the way from the idea of recruitment to indoctrination, redesign of our professional preparation programs, dramatically redesigning them to the continued professional growth, as well as looking at those capacity issues in the school and the systems, and this redesigned relationship between districts and schools. That's where we think accountability ought to be going and the kinds of conversations this community ought to be having as, again, the pioneers who are moving forward. And we're not going to do this without empowering our teachers and others and engaging them directly in this process. I wanted to give you a sense of one of these. Yesterday, some of you had an opportunity to go to a session with the folks from Sanborn, New Hampshire. And Brian and Ellen, I know, are in the audience somewhere. Later on today, there's another session that you'll have an opportunity to go to if you so choose. But to me, this is a prime example of how a state developing a true and open partnership with local school districts can begin to redesign this educational system. They base many of these thoughts on this idea of the 51st state, but it gives you an example of how it can be done. And I can tell you, this, in my mind, is the best example I have seen of how we can put these systems together. You can't read this. I will leave it with you. But basically, you've got a set of district competencies that have been identified. They've wrapped around that robust assessments. They're so deeply thought through. It is an elegant definition of how a local district can begin to develop these enterprises. And the wonderful part of this is that it's a partnership between the state and these local communities. There's trust, there's shared power and resourcing around these issues. I applaud this kind of pioneering effort that's going on in New Hampshire. It's going on in a number of states. We have tremendous opportunities to begin to make these breakthroughs. We're working with a dozen or so states who are wrestling with these same issues. And all I'm asking and I'm pleading for today for you is I want you to be leading this effort. I know you believe in these ideas. I hope you see it a part of your role to begin to be a part of this kind of a definition, a redefinition of learning opportunities for children. So I guess I want to leave you with these questions. Does this sort of vision make some sense to me? Does this sort of conceptual design resonate in your minds? If it doesn't, are you willing to develop one that does make sense? Are you willing to be a part of this sort of transformation in learning, not only a part, but a leader in it? And how can you begin to influence and help others make this vision come alive? What does it mean for students? I think an exciting future that we can't yet envision. I am troubled every day by those students who have lost sight of the joy of learning. I am troubled every day by educators who are frustrated, working very hard and trying to make a difference in the world, and these systems are inhibiting that ability. I am concerned, but I am excited, because I know in this room, as I said earlier, the solutions are here. I'm challenging you to form a partnership with us in the policy arena to make it a reality in every state in this country. I appreciate this opportunity to be with you again and look forward to the conversations we're going to have in the next few years. Thank you so much.
Jean, I'm Susan Patrick, and I'm accepting your challenge. I'm not afraid to do what's right for our kids, and we know that it's a time for rethinking accountability, redesigning accountability, and I just want to give another shout out to New Hampshire. Paul Leather, who's the deputy commissioner, is here. He's doing a session this afternoon on performance-based assessments, rethinking accountability, and rethinking to systems, plural, of assessments, plural, where we have evidence of the student work in performing through performance of their mastery. These performance tasks, these performance-based assessment, the loads of data that are possible in our system for building evidence of student learning along the progressions, including those student supports when they need them and educator supports. And we together, collectively, can help set the vision for what this looks like for our policymakers. So working with you and all of you at iNACL, I take on the commitment and wish you well this morning in your sessions. We'll meet back here for lunch with the student panel and the birds of a feather. Thank you. Thank you again, Jean.